So our first speaker today, as I said, it's a mix of science and non-science. David Troilo. David was a student of Josh. He's back in New York now, and I'll let him speak about his life altogether.
Biology department, the organizer, as well, for putting this together to celebrate Josh's life in science and with his friends. And I'm honored to have been asked to come and speak to you. I was one of Josh's first graduate students. I actually was his second graduate student. Sheila Burns here. Sheila Burns was a graduate student of his in the early 80s. I came in right after her. Sheila worked on Eindhoven's. I worked on myopia. There was always two projects going on in Josh's lab. So the organizers asked me to say a few words about the early days. And they also asked me, I think, Jeanine asked me to say something about what makes Josh the wonderful person that we all knew he was. How did he become that? So I, well, okay, that's a tall order, but I'll give it a little try. And so I want to tell you a little bit about the science that we did back in that time, and how Josh got to City College. And I know a number of you are his friends here from a long time ago when he was in high school. Josh grew up on the Upper East Side. He went to the Bronx High School of Science, Bronx Science. And even there he started, his interest in science began to emerge, and what a great student he was became apparent. And he worked for a time at Rutgers at the Institute for Animal Behavior, where he started to do some great things, even then as a 16-year-old. Looking at his high school yearbook picture, I also noticed that besides being in the photography club and the editor of the yearbook and the president for biology, he was also the lieutenant of the lunchroom squad. And that obviously foreshadowed great interest in food, and we all know how much Josh loved food. He was like a walking Zagat guy. And for me, and the thing, one of the things that really amazed me about Josh is that no matter what city you were in, if you asked him, if you happened to be with him in some other city somewhere, anywhere in the world really, you asked him, well, do you know of any good restaurants? He did. But when he was high school student at the Institute for Animal Behavior, he did some very interesting work on ringneck doves and their mating behavior. And Josh showed that this mating behavior that was very stereotyped could be modified by experiential changes. And that was a really big finding at the time, because it flew in the face of a number of theories of animal behavior, fixed action patterns, and the way behavior was released in certain types of animals. And this work actually made him a finalist in the Westinghouse Awards that he then went on to win. So he was the best known scientist in the United States in 1961. And he went to Washington and was recognized and met JFK, who was president at the time. And Josh was really modest about this, but this was really a big deal. And it was a springboard really for him and his life in science, which kept coming back to the theme of how experience can modify anything from neurophysiology, neuroanatomy, adaptation, and even physical structures like the eye. There's a very interesting story about this picture that Leslie Lee tells in the blog for Josh. Is Leslie here in Brighton? I'll quickly give you this story because it really did foreshadow his life as an example. He's a walking example of Parkinson's law, that work expands to fill the time available. And this picture, Leslie was the yearbook photographer, or the newsletter photographer, and was trying to get Josh to pose for this picture. He was going down as a finalist for the Westinghouse Award, and couldn't get him to sit for the picture. And finally, he the night before he left for Washington, Leslie came to his apartment to take the picture and found that the poster wasn't done. And Leslie actually had to be recruited to help Josh finish the poster and take the photograph. And this was all the night before he went to Washington. And notice that esophagus is spelled wrong. And they were working so quickly that they didn't make that mistake. So it was a springboard for Josh. He went to Harvard, where he worked with George Wald. And I want to tell you just a brief story about something he once said to me when I was a graduate student in his lab. And I was having doubts about my own abilities and whether I could do it, whether I had the right stuff to do the kind of science that was worthy of what he was looking for in his lab. And he told me this story that George Wald once pulled him aside and said that you'll never make a scientist, you'll never become a scientist, you just don't have what it takes. Well, we all know George Wald was obviously wrong about that. And Josh went on to do his PhD at Tufts with Kenneth Roeder. And then after that, he returned to the Institute of Animal Behavior, where he did a one-year postdoc with Daniel Lehrman, and then ended up at City College. And he's been at City College ever since. So he had one faculty position in his career. City College was obviously lucky to have him. And he spoke of grants. I mean, he had a grant in myopia for the entire time he was at City College, so nearly 39 years. And that's really an amazing feat. So when I arrived at the lab, this is what Josh looked like. This is in the early 80s. There's a number of people there. That's our computer, by the way. That was our computer. Carlos, I see here, he was very famous for programming this computer. But we had it was a serious lab. We did a lot of serious science. Yet Josh had this way of making the lab home and treating us all like family. And I think that was true then, and I think it's been true for all the years that his lab has been running. And I think people in the lab today would agree. This is a picture of us. I took this picture so I'm not in it. But you can see that not only did we have a real team feel, some of us, Mena Rojas and Gonzalo Marin, even had children in the lab and raised there. And you can see Josh was quite and was holding Felipe up so that he didn't drive off the table. And I know that we did raise this child as a group because I shared an office with him. Of course, lab lunches were famous. We always lunched together on Wednesdays. And we had a rota, and we would all take turns bringing something in. And it usually had to be something special. And I learned this the hard way because, you know, I resisted. I'm not a foodie. I don't really prepare food, do anything special. So one day I brought cold cuts. Josh, there's been a few times that Josh has been angry with me over the years. And that was probably one of them. And he insisted that I go out and buy a cookbook and get some ideas. Still, we were a serious group, and we did some serious science. And so I want to complete my remarks by just telling you briefly. I went back and I looked at Josh's publication record. He has hundreds of publications. And I looked at, I looked at the 10 that had the most citations. And so I'm just going to quickly give you a sampling of these papers. and I'll tell you just a very little bit about it. I'm not going to try to do any kind of a science talk here. But the paper that had the most citations is the oldest, and that will happen if a paper is so good that it lasts so long. And in this paper that was published in Science in 1978, it was one of the first papers to show that visual experience, or modifying visual experience, can affect the way the eye grows and how it's focused. And this was a springboard paper for his lab in the myopia field. A few years later, with an undergraduate student by the name of Julian Adams, Josh and Julian characterized this phenomenon in another paper that was also one of his top 10 most cited papers. Another science paper came out in 1987. It had the front page, and the cover of this paper, even though it showed an image of the Constitution, which was, at the time was an anniversary of the Constitution, was modified to show how, in the periphery, the images will change. And the paper was basically showing that if you modify different parts of the visual field, the corresponding part of the eye will grow to compensate for it. And it would, you'd get changes in eye shape. So this made it into Science and is one of his top cited papers. I was very lucky to have a few of his top cited papers as well, and they are my top cited papers. This has been a springboard for my own scientific career and my own modest accomplishments in the field. This is a paper that we did with Michael Gottlieb that showed that even in eyes that were disconnected from the brain by cutting the optic nerve section, that these local effects could still take place. So basically Michael's conclusion of this study was that you don't need a brain to be myopic. Another paper of mine that's really made up a lot of my thesis looked at ways that the eye controls its growth, and we showed some evidence that eyes could adjust their growth not only to be longer but to be shorter. And this paper was important at the time, we thought, until a few years later, actually a year later, Frank Schaeffel and Howard Howland showed that with contact or with spectacle lenses that you could do the same thing. So our somewhat, we thought, clever experiment to show this effect, and it was clever because we did it in indirect ways, was sort of overshadowed by this very elegant study on spectacle lenses. And now Josh sees the potential in these kinds of things. So what did we do? He got us together with Frank and Howard Howland. And we published in the next year, we published a paper that showed that in chicks that wear these lenses, that if you stop them from focusing their eyes, they still can compensate for the lenses. Now that was a big deal in the field because everyone thought that these adjustments in eye growth had to do with the way that the eye can change its own focus, the way that you can look at objects at the distance and then look at objects close up. By changing the power of your lens. And we showed in this paper that you don't need that mechanism to get those growth adjustments. Two very important papers that came out of his lab a little later in the 80s were papers that showed that a part of the eye, a vascular part of the eye called the choroid, could adjust its thickness in response to visual cues. And his second most cited paper this is his third most cited paper, and this is a paper by Christine Wiltson and Josh that took that phenomenon and really, really pinned it down and looked at how it worked relative to the changes in eye growth. Deborah Nicola had two papers with Josh that were very heavily cited on diurnal rhythms in the eye and how they relate to the growth of the eye. And these were literally heroic experiments that they did because of the number of measurements that had to be done over several days throughout a 24-hour period. And I was able to do one experiment with Deb on this in Boston on another species, and I can tell you I will never do another one again. And then finally, Josh's second biggest, most cited paper is this wonderful review that he wrote with Jonathan Winter. And this review that's in the journal Neuron is really the most scholarly treatment to that date, at least, on the subject. It brought in all kinds of areas of investigation to put it all together in terms of the question of the control of eye growth and the development of myopia. And it's really as if it had to. It didn't really have to, but it solidified the fact that Josh was such a leader in the field. And perhaps he is no one in this field of regulation of eye growth will ever replace him, in my estimation. So the last thing I want to say is this is probably my favorite picture of Josh that I've seen in all the pictures that we've looked at in the last few months. And this is taken by a friend of his at a diner. I don't know really where the diner was. But it was just, this is the way I'll always think about Josh. This is the way he would sit at lab meetings or sitting in his office talking about science. When he adopted this posture, you knew he was paying attention to you. He didn't always pay attention to you. It's not always easy to get to pay attention, but this is just the way I'll always.